At a time when we're talking about Atmanirbharta, we're talking about self-reliance, there's one organization in India that has implemented this right through. It's almost a beacon of self-reliance. We're talking about the NPCI or the National Payments Corporation of India. It's really leading the charge in terms of digital innovations in the payment space. And joining us to tell us more about it is its MD and CEO, Mr. Dilip Asbhi. So, Asbhi, thank you very much for talking to me now.
Thanks for
Hope you're
having me.
doing well, and it's great to finally get you on the channel. Before I move to what NPCI is doing, the important work that it's been doing, I just want to ask you, sir, the recent data released by RBI shows a V-shaped recovery in terms of payments. So can you tell us what's happening? Is this pent-up demand, or is this an actual demand that we're seeing on the ground? Because if we look at data from FMCG companies, it's been positive in the last few weeks. People are talking about demand coming back in rural especially. So what can you tell us about that?
No, you are right. The data is looking better now. We saw a huge dip in the month of April, but we saw May some sort of recovery, and we were coming back to the closure of the March numbers. And now I think in the month of June we are closer back to the Feb numbers, which is like obviously there is some element of loss because we always anticipate month-on-month growth. But at least the good news is we are back to the Feb numbers, and obviously I believe that the growth will continue. Now obviously again it depends on how the COVID situation emerges back in the city, because some of the places again the lockdowns have been started. But even if I believe that if it remains back on the similar situation, I think we should see a good growth on digital payments this year.
Right. What is really driving this, sir? Any qualitative, quantitative data or anecdotes that you can share with
Yeah.
us in terms of what is driving this surge? Is
So,
it rapid adoption? Is it first-time users? What's really driving this?
we see a good growth on the consumption-based categories, which is predominantly the grocery, the essentials, and those categories. And we are also seeing recently, lately, the demand on the electronics and across the payment systems, on UPI, RuPay, both. We are seeing a good demand back on the electronics, which might be a pent-up demand. So that's why I said, we might have to see how the COVID situation remains back in the country, and hopefully the growth will start. And I think, like demonetization, the growth on digital payments have been fairly fairly good, and we are seeing good amount of new users joining back on digital payments. Obviously, for a country like us, it's never enough in life. So we believe that growth will continue.
Right. And any other green shoots that you're seeing at this point, sir, say in terms of IMPS transactions?
So we saw and it was aided by the DBT. We saw a good growth back in the AEPS transactions, and which was primarily relying back on the DBTs, what the government did, whether it's a PM Jan Kalyan Yojana or Kisan Yojana or those kind of schemes. The government did a large number of DBTs, and which kind of we saw reflected back in the AEPS transactions, which is touching near to all AEPS. Obviously, it includes authentication, honest transactions, the non-financials, and all the transactions. But it was encouraging to see that AEPS reaching out close to 500,000 transactions on a monthly basis.
Right. And in terms of the qualitative or the quantitative changes in behavior pre-lockdown, post-lockdown, anything that you can share there, sir?
So we see that ticket sizes are improving. So we see that for example, there is an improvement in the ticket size by 10 to 20% across the categories. But predominantly that could be because people don't want to go outside for many times, so they want to kind of sit on some of the inventories, so they want to limit the exposures. That could be one of the reason. But we see definitely there is a growth on 20% on the ticket sizes on as far as UPI and UPI is concerned.
Right. And how is it working in terms of last mile connectivity? So in terms of business correspondence, micro ATMs, how is it working out?
So, we rely back on technology, tech infrastructure, which has been created by the telcos. And thanks to Jio, Airtel, and Vodafone Idea, they have been really the backbone of in this COVID situation, because most of the places we have relied back on the telecom operators, and that's how the transaction and continuation on the of the transactions have happened in last 3-4 months, where people didn't want to come out of their houses, whether it's a whether it's a mobile business correspondent going back to from village to village and reaching out to the right audience. But this networks have played a big role in our assessment to ensure that the transactions continue to happen, right? Normally we don't give enough credit back to the backbone infrastructure companies, but I would like to highlight that all these three companies have played a tremendous role to ensure to support the customers as well as the last mile touch points like business correspondent to continue to ensure that continue to be available so that the customers can continue to do the digital transactions in this tough times.
Right. And what did it take to really keep all this going during COVID-19? What kind of challenges did you face? How has your own management style or behavior or the way NPCI functions, how has that had to change in order to adapt to this new norm?
See, look, I think these are the tough times. So if anybody says that, he's fully riding this tiger, I won't be able to believe that. So it's obviously an unknown situation at this stage. But I must say that, we have been fairly fortunate to have the committed employees in NPCI. And, we, for example, the initial 1 month or 1.5 months, we operated with a very fairly bare minimum staff, say about 10% on an overall basis. But then we saw when a lot of employees saw that, this is going to be like, run till we have vaccine in place. So which means that maybe a year more. So I think most of us felt that, this is going to be the new normal. And, we see now about 30-35% of the employees have been coming regularly last 6 weeks back to office and trying to execute projects, products, and what are the new changes we wanted to deliver back overall perspective. And happy to say that even the digital ecosystem has been fairly active. So it is not that, we saw a lot of dull moment in digital payments and the projects which we have been doing with the ecosystem. We see the banks, the fintechs have been equally working to drive newer things, newer features back on the systems. And next 2 months' time, you would see a lot of changes, a lot of new announcement by a lot of players, including NPCI in the market, whether it's the RuPay, UPI, or those products, or AEPS for that matter. We have been working back with the UIDAI for the face authentication to be launched on the in the field, which is the contactless AEPS. So we see, so it's not only NPCI. What I want to say is, a lot of players, a lot of institutions have been working silently in this COVID period.
Right. Before I come to what's next in terms of the innovations, Aadhaar-enabled payments of AEPS payments really took off in the last few months. Nandan Nilekani also mentioned this when we spoke to him a few weeks ago. And it's really amazing how the JAM Treaty has kind of helped India ensure that essentials cash reaches everyone on time. So tell us a little about that in terms of the adoption you saw through AEPS.
Again, I must say that, a lot of hard work by a lot of entities, whether it's banks, bank employees who are bank agents trying to work as a business correspondent, the fintech companies, a lot of fintech companies have recently started acting as a BC agents back to the bank. So they kind of working in spite of the COVID period. Similarly, the examples, the payments bank, you look at Airtel Payments Bank, look at the Department of Post kind of converting all their the last mile delivery employees to a mobile micro ATM. A lot of effort has been gone through, because seeing the 500 million transaction is not a joke on a physical system. While UPI is a digital system where we rely back on a smartphone and consumer doing the payment to consumer whose self, you know, he can do the transaction by himself. While in AEPS, you know, there has to be a meeting of a business correspondent and a consumer, then only the transaction happens, right? So in that particular situation, in COVID times, we could see half a billion transaction. I think it's a miracle of both the last mile VC entities and the consumers coming together and doing this transaction. So a lot of hard work, and you know, we have seen, you know, a lot of entities reaching out back to the government to get the various permissions. And you know, I must give credit back to the government as well, because whatever it is, you know, I think government also believe that, you know, there is a need to bring in the clarity for you know, the financial institutions like NPCI or the business correspondent institutions or the banks to work this 24/7 and ensure that whatever happens, this financial system doesn't breaks up, you know, it doesn't stop, you know, comes to a standstill situation. So I think whilst with a great support from the government and the ecosystem players, I think great number on APS in last 3 months time.
Right. So if I look at what NPCI is doing, if I look at UPI, it really showcases India's soft power. So while China has been able to build the physical infrastructure in terms of roads, rails, India has tried to leapfrog and build a digital infrastructure at scale. So tell me about this journey of self-reliance that you managed to build in the payment space, and how this has helped India. How has India managed to build an Atmanirbhar payment rail for itself?
So, you know, and I think the journey goes back, you know, a few years back. And while we started NPCI, in the initial few years, we kind of RBI, whatever the work RBI was doing, RBI outsourced back to NPCI. So we predominantly started doing the ATM switching, the check clearing, the operational part of RBI, which was supposed to hive off to back to NPCI. And obviously, you know, and I must give credit back to Mr. Hota, who had innovation back in his DNA. And, you know, he kind of drove back right from day zero of NPCI that we must innovate. Right. Obviously, you know, the other credit is, you know, we have no other choice. Right. You know, because, you know, we didn't have the proven global platforms like other international card schemes for that matter. So we had to innovate, and we started on fairly early in the NPCI journey. And, you know, look at IMPS, you know, we launched in 2010 in the first year of NPCI when there was no need of IMPS technically. But we kind of remained patient. We knew that we have created a value. And so in next 3 to 4 years time, we started seeing the success. Similarly, you know, when we launched even UPI, for that matter, you know, first 1 year was not very that bright. You know, a lot of people, I still remember a lot of people coming back to me saying that, you know, boss, this is not taking off. You need to do something different. So we were patient, obviously, but going back to the point, you know, NPCI believed that, you know, we have to innovate, and we have to create a innovation which is local to India, which is because number of times which we had seen that it's a 1.2 billion population country, and you know, we have to create something which is very, very localized, which is not there outside, because our needs are different. Mm-hmm. Our needs are not that fairly standard, and basis the variety of economic strata we have. We need to have that different solutioning approach back. If you look at, we kind of strike the partnership back with UIDI long back in 2009 itself. Right from day zero, we were together to design the whether it's a DBT platform for India or designing the AEPS system. Actually, you know, if you look at it, first 3 years, the AEPS transactions actually were like handful. You know, first 3-4 years of while after designing the APS. So some of the systems were little ahead of time, but we were very clear that these systems are local. These systems are customized for Indians, and you know, it will. There is no better model than this. We were very clear right from the beginning in NPCI, and fortunately, the banks and the ecosystem and the support from RBI actually helped us to play that long-term game. Right, you know, nobody came back and said that, you know, no, this is not picking up for a year or 2 years. You know, you kind of take a different route. So a lot of support to NPCI has helped us to be patient And, you know, obviously at the end of the day, we saw the success in most of the platforms which we built.
Right. And we're seeing the government taking action towards self-reliance, whether it's measures in priority sectors, changes in FDI rules, or the recent ban on Chinese apps, 59 Chinese apps. I think there are a few Chinese apps that also operate through UPI, like your MePay. So, you know, will that also be touched? How you're kind of ensuring Atmanirbharta there, considering payment is more crucial, payment data is more important? How are you dealing with this?
See, there are two ways to look at it. Obviously, one way is, those UPI apps are not part of the list of the government. And, you know, right. If they have been there, you know, we would have, we had no choice but to shut them off. So, we'll obviously reach back to the government and see what we need to do as, reach out to the government and RBI and see what we should do as far as these two apps. Right now, not a lot of traffic is flowing to them. So, we are not really worried about that part. The second part about this is actually UPI as an ecosystem is not really, really dependent on any of the apps for that matter. You know, the way UPI has been designed is, you know, UPI kind of drives once somebody is onboarded onto UPI on using one app. You know, technically for him to use the other app is just a matter of downloading that other app and start using it, because, you know, you have already done the onboarding. You have already set your UPI pin. So it's only a matter of, you know, downloading that other app and start using it. While I don't want to discredit, a lot of efforts has been taken by the leading app providers. So I really don't want to say that, you know, they have not put in effort. They have put in a lot of efforts. But what I'm trying to say that, you know, UPI as an ecosystem, the way architecture has been built up, it has almost near to, you know, close to zero switching cost. You know, when it comes from consumer trying to look at using from one app to the other app, and that's where you can say the true value of the interoperable payment system, right? You know, you can use any app. You have a choice of using any merchant. So that's kind of part of UPI design from day zero.
Right. You recently tweeted that the world needs UPI ready for a billion a day sooner or later. So what kind of global ambitions do you have? Because I remember this report where the US Fed is considering this system. And I think you had also signed an MOU with Singapore to take this to Southeast Asian countries.
Yeah.
So what kind of global ambitions do you have? What next for UPI?
So what we have done is recently, with the permission from RBI and the government, we have started our own NPCI International subsidiary, full-blown subsidiary, which is going to only focus on the NPCI's international ambitions. And, we are looking at, you know, obviously it's very, very early days. We just the NPCI International just started about a month back, actually. We think as of now that, you know, there is a possibility that, you know, the world might be able to leverage on the assets which has been created by NPCI in last few years. And the RBI and government is also very, very supportive of this whole thought process that, you know, we should take India as a brand name back wherever is possible, whichever country is willing to use that, you know, we should offer our services back on to them to process their payments, to create a gateways, the international gateways to process cross-border transactions, remittances. Obviously, it's an early start and, you know, it's a very, very time-consuming activity. But, you know, we are hoping that next 2 years, 3 years' time, we are able to see some success on whether we are able to leverage the assets which has been created by us in the global situation. So that tweet was actually a sales tweet.
But any particular geographies where you're optimistic of driving this, or where you would have already made an assessment of the market based on initial interest?
The way we look at it, you know, many countries looking at India and some of the other markets, you know, many countries are now looking at to create a domestic rails like the UPI for the real-time payments and asset-light merchant payments. We see Asian countries, some of the Asian countries, some of the African countries and the Middle East countries are in the process of creating that. So we see that as a good approach market to start our work with.
So that would kind of complete the circle. India is not just self-reliant, but you're also taking the innovation for the world, building local and taking it global. But Mr. Azbi, UPI was really a game changer because sending money now is like sending a message or a mail. So, and you've also pioneered the RuPay cards. But what next? What's the next big thing going to be from NPCI? If you have to give us one or two game changers or offerings that you're planning, say in the next 6 months, the next 1 year, if you've had to accelerate that because of the COVID situation, what can customers expect in the near term?
No, see, look, you know, it's very, going to be very difficult to tell me that, what we will do in the long term. But at the short term, what we are looking at, you know, some of the approvals which we already have from the RBI in terms of, whether can we launch the recurring payments, you know, which is in the next two to three months time. You know, this is like, you know, game changer, in my assessment, the way regulator has structured this whole product, because, you know, about 80-85% transactions are below 2,000 in that, for that matter. And if you are able to convert them back into the recurring payments, you know, it kind of, it takes the user experience back to the next level, you know, in my estimate. So this is one thing which we have been, which we have the approval and which we have been working on, which we'll figure out a way to launch this in next few months. We are also trying to see that, you know, how the whole UPI experience or the RuPay experience goes back to the next level. So, be it the tokenization part on RuPay, be it how the merchant and consumer interaction becomes fairly much easier than what it is right now, when there are connectivities are not there. So a lot of plans we have, and you know, that's why I said, you know, 30% of NPCI has been working last 6-8 weeks in the office. So a lot of work is in progress, but we'll have to see. You know, I don't know what we will be able to launch and what we will not be. But I think there are plans, and you know, we plan to make some changes in next few months and to adjust back with the changed behavior of the consumer due to COVID-19.
Right. Mr. Azbi, you're a veteran of the digital payment space. And while India has built the rails, we have an India first innovation, why is it that the apps on top of it are not, Indian in its DNA? I mean, if I look at the top UPI apps, it would be a Google Pay, an Amazon Pay, a Walmart-owned Phone Pay, WhatsApp Pay.
That Phone Pay was an Indian startup. You know, we met them when they had nothing. You know, and 2 years down the line, you know, they Walmart actually acquired, and I believe Walmart also.
No, is it because we are still in the
early stage when it comes to... was as equal asset as Flipkart, you know. So I'm saying you can't discount that. Yes, but, as I said in the beginning, you know, I don't believe that, you know, we are too bothered about, you know, who's using the railroads. That the railroads are there for anybody to come and use the railroads. So we don't look at, you know, he's the Indian player, he's the foreign player. So our approach has been standard for all the players who are participating and using the railroads. Being said that, you know, obviously we would want to promote the Indian startups and the fintechs which are working in India. And we have various programs which we have started working last 1 year with the Indian startups in terms of not only, you know, only using the apps or whatever it is, but even NPCI using them, you know, I told you that last few years, you know, whatever systems we have built, we have been using extensively the Indian fintech community to build the products, some of the products what we have, and we'll continue to do that. So I agree with you that, you know, we should see some Indian fintechs running the apps. We have been waiting for Jio to come and take a market share. I just hope they will do that soon.
Right. This is a question that's on everybody's minds. WhatsApp Pay, is it going to finally make it in 2020? I know there are a lot of factors that are not in your control, but how is it progressing? Any update that you can give us?
It's a work in progress.
That's been one of the most eagerly waited products.
It's a work in progress right now.
Work in progress. Yes. And what targets do you have for the rest of the year, Mr. Azbi?
No, I don't think we are looking at any target, but I think, you know, as a from a potential standpoint, as and I keep talk, we keep talking within NPCI a lot. In fact, you know, one of our conclaves during the start of this year, the conclave was named based on the theme of billionaire deal. So we believe that there is a potential of potential for Indian payment system to do a billionaire deal, and I think that is what we are making ourselves ready for, whether it's system processes and the ecosystem readiness to reach to the billionaire deal. And obviously a lot of support would be required, banks and fintechs to reach that. Only our NPCI being ready won't be helpful, but billion a day is something what I think the Indian payment ecosystem should look forward to.
Right. On that note, Sasuke, thank you very much for talking to ET now, and I hope you achieve your billion a day target. So hopefully the next time we have an interview in a few months down the line, that will be the number that we see NPCI clocking. But thank you very much for talking to ET now.
Thank you.